Okay, ladies, welcome here in Rotterdam.
Thank you.
Thank you.
How are you feeling, Aisha?
I'm feeling good, yes, a little bit nervous, but I think that's part of it. I'm really excited.
Okay, and where are you excited about?
I'm really excited to talk about things that matter, because in pageants, that's one of my favorite things, giving back to society and learning about different topics and stuff like that.
Did you learn a lot till now?
Yes, today we have a few subjects that we are going to talk about. And we are also learning about a feminist that I did not know up till now. So it was very interesting to learn about her, yes.
Yeah, we'll hear about that later. Cheyenne, how do you feel?
I'm also very excited. I'm looking forward to talk about subjects that matter, such as education and women suffrage. So and I've learned a lot. I prepared a little bit. Well, we had the subjects yesterday, but I guess it's good to...
But you didn't receive any question.
No. So that's very exciting.
Yeah.
Looking forward to it.
What is your biggest fear for today?
My biggest fear? Well... I have prepared, but yeah, it's always possible to get a blackout, and I hope that that won't happen. But
okay, Janie, what about you?
I'm feeling very good today. I am really excited, a little bit nervous too, but I really get motivated with these girls, and I'm feeling like we have definitely a sisterhood, so everything is gonna be okay.
Okay. Danique, did you talk about today together? Because you're group one.
Yeah, we did. Yeah, before we made a group WhatsApp and we already talked about the subject and we discussed some things, but it's still hard that we don't have the questions, so...
Yeah, but if you have an interview, you can only be yourself and show the people who you are. So tell me, Jamie, what is a fun fact that people should know about you?
A fun fact about me is from the outside, I'm just looking like a girly girl, but I definitely like to drive in cars really fast. I get that adrenaline kick.
You're the female Verstappen.
Yes. I definitely want to ride on a circuit in a sports car.
Oh, wow.
So yeah, that's a fun fact about me. Not everybody knows that. But when my friends are driving with me in my car, they always say, "Oh my God, Jenny, slow down."
Oh, okay.
But I'm really confident with driving. So they are not afraid when they're with me.
What about you, Cheyenne? Tell us a fun fact about yourself.
I kind of get that experience that people think, "Oh, you're so girly, always with heels and dresses." But actually, I also have a bit of a tough side, and that is...
A male in you.
You can say it like that, yes. Because I love kickboxing. So, and my bucket list is to one day do a match. But I have to train a lot more.
And you just ran the marathon in Rotterdam.
Yeah. Yes, I also
How
did
was
that?
That?
It was amazing. Yeah, I did 12.5 kilometers, but it was my first time. It was such an amazing experience. The weather was amazing, and it was so great to have all the people cheer you on while you're running, and it was amazing. Yeah, I loved it.
Yeah, okay. Danique, tell us a fun fact about you.
Yeah, I think it fits with the other girls that from the outside I look like a nice girly girl. But from the inside, I'm a national athlete in karate, so, and people do not expect that.
No. So each one of you has a little bit of a male side. That's exciting. Do you also have a male side, Aisha?
Yeah, definitely. I used to be a lot of a tomboy. But something that a lot of people also don't know about me is that I love animals. I'm crazy about animals. I've been a vegetarian for about 2 or 2.5 years now. I decided to go vegetarian when I was about 18 because I couldn't enjoy eating meat anymore, knowing the process that those animals had to go through and how brutal the bio industry is, etc. So I'm a proud vegetarian for almost 3 years now.
Okay, and it's not tough?
It's tough sometimes because I really enjoy meat. I love it. I think it tastes good, but it's not worth it for me. Sometimes you have to have priorities, and the well-being of animals and our climate, etc., is much more important to me than enjoying meat for a few minutes.
Yeah, that's the good spirit, ladies. So now you all have a beauty with a purpose, and you all are ambassadors for the United Nations. What is your SDG?
I have two, actually. I have gender equality and well-being and health.
And why did you choose for those subjects?
Well, I've always been a proud feminist. I think it's really important to be a feminist and to speak up about it. There are so many misconceptions about what feminism is and what feminist stands for. So I try to shine light on what it is and try to bring awareness for it. And it's also really important that everyone in the world gets has access to healthcare, I think, and gets to grow up in a safe environment. So those are two things that are really close to my heart, and that's why I chose them.
Okay. Well, more about that. Beauty with a purpose is so important. Cheyenne, what is yours? Because you also picked an SDG which you're going to represent, right?
Yes, definitely. I've chosen poverty and social inequality. And that's more for people who have a disease and who cannot work anymore. So I would love to help them and raise awareness for this subject. And this actually comes from personal experience, because my mom was diagnosed with breast cancer a couple of years ago, and she recovered. So, but this process was very hard, very tiring process for her. And I have experienced this with my mom, and I know how excluded she felt from society. So that's why I want to help people and to do something back. Yeah.
We're certainly going to follow up on that, Cheyenne.
Yes.
Thank you so much. Janie, what is your SDG? What are you going to stand for and plead for?
My SDG is climate change. And I chosen that SDG because it's really important that we keep our planet healthy, not only for ourselves, but also for the animals, because I see how many animals are suffering or are dying, and that had so many consequences for us because we have to eat. That's one thing. The planet is warming up, and when it keeps going, there is no planet anymore for our next generation, and it's really important that we're standing up for that. But lately I saw that there was a statement with different countries. They are cutting, they are stopping with cutting off the woods. So that's really good that that's not going to happen anymore. And I think the little changes begins by yourself. So if anyone does something for the planet, we'll stay strong, and the planet too. So, and I want to make people aware of that.
Yeah, very good, Janie. Thank you so much. Danique, last but not least, what is your SDG?
My SDG is...
And also your beauty with a purpose,
yeah,
of course.
It's linked to well-being and health. And my beauty with a purpose is focusing on young adults that are suffering from social pressure and performance pressure. As we see now in our generation, there's a lot of pressure coming from work, family, home, friends. And I think we should do something about that, because people are reaching their limits, and you cannot do everything.
No, so true. Thank you, ladies. This was round one. We just saw your introductions. A short and brief little thing about your beauty with a purpose and linked to the SDGs. So we are going to be right back with you in a few seconds. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. This is group one of the head-to-head challenge. You just met them in the introduction. And their beauty with a purpose. Amazing, you all are. And keep on doing the good stuff and keep on spreading the word and making awareness of the things that matters to you. So thank you for that. Next up is you all got a subject. And the subject in this group one was education. Tough one. So I have a question for you, and you're going to show the people that you are really empowering each other and we are world family and your sisterhood. So do you feel that schools in the Netherlands, because we are from the Netherlands, the school system, should it be changed? Because now children of 12 years of age have to make a choice and they have to go in that direction. How do you feel about it, and how do you feel other than, are they being forced, or do you think there must be a change?
Well, if I can go first.
Yes, go ahead.
Well, I think it's a difficult question, first of all, but it's really important to think about it. We have like levels in the Netherlands. You can go to like a low education level or a very high education level. I think that when children are 12 and they are forced to go to one of these levels, it may not always be correct. But for those children, it's really hard to level up.
If you see your own personal situation, you are a little bit older than 12 now.
Yes.
Right. How did you feel at 12 years and had to make the choice, and you're not making the choice, they're making the choice for you and you're forced to do that?
Well, when I was 12 years old, they actually wanted me to go to MAVO, the middle level, but my mom, she knew that I was capable of going to the HAVO, but my school said, no, we're not going to send Alyssa to the HAVO because she cannot do that. So my mom is really a first lady, so she talked to the school and they sent me to do a special test that allowed me to go to the HAVO. But I think my story is a good example of children who are capable of much more, who are being sent to lower levels and in that way are not capable of expressing everything that they can do. So I think they are holding children back in a lot of ways.
Okay. Interesting. Yes. Cheyenne, you are saying yes, huh?
Yes.
So tell me,
yes,
what is your experience?
I agree with you that on the one hand, of course, children need some kind of direction, so I understand where the system is coming from. But I also believe it's very hard to just take one test and then decide such a big decision for the rest of children's lives upon that one test. So I think it would be better to also look at other aspects. Such as creativity. Because now you have to do like math and it's one test, but also creativity should
be... At 12 it's math and language. That's
languages,
the most important,
yes,
that they look at, right?
Yes, definitely.
Yeah.
But I also believe that creativity should be rewarded more and stimulated. So, as you said, children can do much more, and even though they are in a low level then, maybe they have other specialties that
qualities
should be rewarded more, yeah.
Danique, what is your experience? Because you also teach young children, right?
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
Like, more the problem that I see is that people always say that there are different levels. But I don't really believe in the levels. I mean, that a child can be really good with their hands and, like you said, can be really creative. And then people say that they go to a lower level. But I think that every level is like the same, but one level is more focusing on mathematics, more to study, and the other level is more focusing on jobs doing with your hands. But I think the main problem in the Netherlands is that everyone sees that there's a difference in levels, but everyone is good in what they do. And everyone is important in our society. So maybe we should stop looking at the levels, but really looking at what people can do. And then if we focus that on schools, we can say that they're not really levels. We can say this school is more for creative children, and this school is more for children that want to study more, but not that there's like a really level system.
Jenny, if you would have the power to change the law in that, what would you change?
I will change that every child can choose by herself or himself what she can or wants to do. Because when you are in group 8 and you're
12 then, right?
Yeah, you're 12 and your outcome of the test is HAVO, but you want a lower education because you can do much more with your hands, that can be proven. So she can, if she wants that, do a lower level because she wants to work with her hands and not because she can do a HAVO. She has to do that, no. And I think it's really important to look to the mentality of the child and not only to look what she can write or how she good is in math or something like that. And I think it's really important to see that change.
Okay. You all agree with that? Or
yes.
Do you want to add something? If you would have the power to make that change, what would it be?
Well, I wouldn't really call the levels. I would rather call them directions. Like one direction would be focusing more on, like she said, you know, mathematics and languages. And other directions would focus more on the creative side, like painting or even acting and such things.
And don't you feel that the age of 12 might be too young to push children into a direction?
Yes, but I think it's what's happening right now too. So I definitely
that's something you told a little bit about Beauty with a Purpose.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, you're really like pushing into one direction. And what I experienced when I went to the VWO, you had to choose like in the third grade, you had to choose a next direction.
And what age was that? 14, 15?
14, 15. And I didn't know what to do. So I chose the economic part. And then when I finished, I was looking at different studies to do. And for example, I couldn't enter some studies because I didn't choose the right subjects. But I didn't know that when I was 14 because I didn't know what I wanted to become. So yeah, if you look at the age, maybe we should say that between 12 and 14, just let them go.
Yes.
And then later they can choose what they really want.
Yeah, keep it more general.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you so much. Anything you want to add?
Yes, I would also like to see a bit more focus on collaboration, because right now in the school system there's a lot of focus on competition, because you have to have the highest grade, of course, and yeah, I think this stimulates a little bit of competition instead of collaboration, working in groups, working together. So I would love to see that in the school system.
That's a good advice. Thank you so much, ladies. That was the theme and subject of education. Next up, we're going to look at something very, very interesting, right?
Yes.
See you right back. Thank you.
Okay.
Welcome back. And this is the final part of your head-to-head challenge. You ready?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
So yesterday, you got a power woman on your plate. Which one was that?
Emily Pankhurst.
I was in choir. What did you learn about this phenomenal woman?
Well, she started the suffragettes, which are a group of women that are fighting for suffrage in England. It was in the 19th century, so you can imagine that this was a time that women were supposed to do the household, take care of the children, and they were not working. But they wanted to make a change.
Can you tell me something about that change, Jamie?
Yes, Emmeline was a very political activist, and she was standing for her rights. And one of the rights was to vote in the parliament, like other men too. She wanted
to have equal rights
yes,
for women.
Yes, she wants to have an equal with men and women. And not only that you can vote, but also that women can work. Because in that time, most women were housewives. Like, oh yeah, you're a wife, so you're only good in housekeeping, blah, 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 blah. But she was standing for us. No, no, we are women, we are strong. And she created a really big empowerment with all the women, and that's why she was a founder of the Women's Social Political Union.
Yeah.
And
can you tell me something about that, Danique?
About the social political union?
Yes.
as she said, she was the founder of it, and there she was really striving to get the rights for the women. And in the end, she did.
Yeah.
Is she still alive?
No. Already 200 years.
Yeah, 1928, I believe.
And she experienced the pressure of World War I.
Yes.
Yeah. Misha, can you tell something about that? What happened?
Well, when the war started, she put all their activities on hold. She thought, if there's not a country to vote in, then what are we fighting for? So she put all the activities of the union on hold and started advocating for women to be able to work in factories. She thought all men should be sent to the front to fight in the wars. She was very active in that. And when the war ended, they continued their fight for women's rights.
Was she a single kid, or did she have sisters, brothers?
She had a sister who actually died.
One or two?
I don't know, but I know of the one who passed, sadly, in one of the protests that went on.
Cheyenne?
Yeah, I believe she had more sisters, and also her husband was a lawyer, and this gave her a little bit of status, I believe. And she also needed that, because a couple of times she was in prison.
Because
she was rallying and setting houses on fire, because apparently these acts were necessary to get suffrage for women. But yeah, she ended up in prison, and she even had to starve herself to make a point. And this was actually...
But they forced her to eat.
Yes, forced her to eat through her nose. It was awful. Mm-hmm. But in the end, these kind of acts were seen.
What did Emmeline thought you, Janie?
Sorry, can you formulate that again?
What did Emmeline taught you?
Oh, what she taught me? She definitely taught me to stand up for yourself, that we are equal to men, that we are worth it, and we can. We have so much to offer as a woman, and we are capable of so many things for our society. And not only a man can work with political things, women too. And we are smart. So, yeah.
Certainly we are.
Yeah.
Yeah. Danique, can you add something to that?
Of course.
Why do you admire her? Because I think before I came up with these women, did you ever heard of her?
No, I never heard her name before.
And now, how do you feel about knowing her?
I think she really shows that you should never give up.
Yes.
Because she has been in prison for like 3 times, and still after that she still wanted to fight and for her own rights and for the rights of other women. And it also shows that if you stand for something, you're never alone, because she got a really big group of girls and women that supported her. And also her men really supported her.
And do you see that back now in the competition with Miss Mold, where you are in now with the girls here?
Yeah, I think we're really like a group of girls, and yeah, like we already said, like sisterhood. Like yesterday when we talked about what we had to do today, for example, some of us were busy with work and the other was already making summaries to help us out.
Yeah.
So yeah, we're really like a team, and we support each other. And yeah, that's what we also see with her.
Yeah, and what about you? What are your thoughts about Emmeline?
Well, in the time that she was alive, there was a lot of resistance from the people to everything that she said and everything that she stood for. And I imagine it must have been very difficult for her sometimes, you know, stand your ground and not let other people's opinions tear you down. Because the suffragettes were, of course, seen as, you know, savage women, stupid women. They were portrayed horribly in the media. And I think that she taught me a lot about, you know, you just standing your ground and fighting for your rights despite everyone's opinion about you. She was very strong in that.
So you add Emmeline to your list of examples now?
Yes, definitely. Yes.
Yeah, she is right. Thank you so much, ladies.
Thank you.
Thank you for being here today. Thank you for your input. And ladies and gentlemen, you can start voting for them and just support them. Go on socials and follow them. Thank you so much.
Thank you for having us.